and good afternoon to everyone present here, our respected speaker, my seniors, my colleagues, and my dear students. Today we are having amongst us Dr. Dharmesh Gupta sir. I feel very much privileged to give you all brief profile of sir. He is an accomplished and result-driven telecom IT professional, having over 24 years of experience in telecom domain, successfully managing multiple large-scale technology projects and software development for enterprise. In his roles, including top management, he apply practical knowledge and achieve critical business goals and make coherent contribution to bottom line of the organization. Today, he will talk about innovation for self-reliant India, focus on managing user-driven innovation. I will like to add upon that innovation is in Sir's DNA. For him, innovation is verb, that is action, not a noun, that is static. Currently, he is associated with Vedang Radio Technology Private Limited, Mumbai, as a vice president for technology, while he works on responsibility including managing product and solution engineering in telecom and IP domain, including product ideation, technical development, product testing, end user training and rollout. In today's session, he would like to draw attention how to identify the problems and focus on innovation and inculcate a culture of innovation and thus create a vibrant entrepreneurial economy for the nation, India becoming Atmanirbhar country. So I welcome you, sir, on behalf of Sage University and Computer Science Department. And I also like to thank R.P. Mahajan, sir, for getting an opportunity for all of us to come here for the session. So now I would like to ask Lalji Prasad, sir, to welcome, sir.
Hello.
Thank you, Ati. Thank you.
हेलो
हाँ सर आवाज आ रही है
हेलो यस यस हेलो
यस सर आपकी आवाज आ रही है
ओके वेलकम सर यहाँ पर सेज यूनिवर्सिटी आई वेलकम यू
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you indeed.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Now start.
Sir, right. I would like to request. May I start the video?
Yes,
yes.
Yes. Okay.
Hello. Dharmesh sir, I request you to start with your session.
Very good afternoon. Very good afternoon to professors, my seniors, and my colleagues. Students are my colleagues. Thank you so much for providing me or giving me this opportunity to share some thoughts on innovation, Self-Reliant India, and how do we go about it. Although this presentation is not a structured one, and I usually prefer such presentation to be an interactive, but because of this technology limitation, you are
louder, please. You are not audible.
I'm not audible. Is it better? Any better? Hello. Can I have a feedback? Is this?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It is better now.
Okay. And I think you are able to see the screen as well. All right. So thank you once again. The topic for today's seminar has three key words in that, is the innovation. What is the context of Self-Reliant India for us? And how do we achieve that in a limited way or in a particular way? And I have chosen to be a user-driven innovation. If this has a pathway for entrepreneurship. The next slide, which shares the agenda, I have divided this session, about 40-minute session, into two main aspects. One is setting the scene. It's like setting the context, where we are in India, what are our priorities, some of the key issues. I'll touch upon one or two key issues that will give us a direction. And then to solve that issue, why innovation is important. So, and when we talk about innovation, what is our understanding about innovation? Its basic definition, fundamental definition, some of the myths if you want to touch upon. And then we move on to user innovation. On this aspect, the second part, which is the user innovation, I would like to go with an example rather than being a theoretical aspect of innovation and user innovation in the context of reverse innovation, how can you go about it? Okay. And then we can have some time for question and answers if you have any. So in this section, setting the context, let's look at the five top economies of the world in last five decades. As we see USA, Japan, Germany, India, and China, in 1980s, if we compare ourselves with China, 1980s, we were almost at the same level in terms of the GDP, gross GDP, I would say. But in the decade of 90 and 2000, China took a leap. And thereafter, not just leap, it's a leaps and bounds, the economy was growing on. While US economy was growing at a regular pace and significantly higher, but China made a significant leap into this direction. And India's economy remains almost same, almost relatively same, and the growth rate is relatively low. So there are many explanations for this slide. And I would just suggest that I would say one aspect that China has taken this leap is primarily based on infrastructure growth and infrastructure for manufacturing. China is now the global factory for the world. They can produce for the entire population of the world. That much infrastructure they have. Now it's, and when we look at India actually, India has also can take a leap in manufacturing sector. But as I look back, and we not necessarily need to go about it, I chosen and we'll see why we can choose another way of getting into the same strain or same speed of growth and the same leak of growth in that domain. So the next slide I shared, one particular issue of India in terms of, are you seeing the slides clearly? Ms. Sati?
Yes, sir. We are able to see your slides.
Okay, because I see
you
some slides.
You can start slideshow also.
Yeah,
you can see the screen, sir.
Okay. So if you see the economy or GDP contribution for India, I have taken 2010 aspect, and this is same as 2019 as well, that the contribution of the agriculture has reduced from 54% to 14% in 2010, and in 2019 about 13.67%. Similarly, the GDP contribution of industry in GDP has also declined to some extent, and it is increased to 26 to 27%, while the contribution of service industry or service into the GDP has increased to 60%. But if we see the contribution of employment to this sector, that is significantly skewed. See, for example, the agriculture, which employs about 53-54% of the workforce, contributes only 13-14% of the GDP. While service, which employs about 25-26% of the employee or the workforce, contributes about 60% of it. So you can see the skew in our economy in our country. Now, our economy is primarily service-based. And if we change significantly to the manufacturing, as we get into the significant leap into the manufacturing, I think our manufacturing is for ourselves, is for the self-reliant. We are not to become a world factory in this domain. Rather than we have to innovate for ourselves, we have to solve our problem so that we become a self-reliant. Self-reliant doesn't mean that we look inwards. Self-reliant essentially means that our dependency on critical aspect or critical segment or in sector should remain. So innovation comes to us as one significant factor that we can use it. And the promise for innovation is that it increases the revenue, the bottom line, profitability, and the services, and the overall lifestyle as a whole. If we take Apple, its promise is it increases the revenue by significant percentage. At the same time, if we take the Indian companies also, where the revenue increases significantly. Here are two examples of the Google and Apple for you to correlate this. So when I say, if we take the innovation, then Atmanirbhar means that we focus on our needs. We do the right thing which is required to be done, rather than doing the things which is needed in the protocol, in the conventional way. Our social needs are significantly appealing to us or significantly pressing, whether it's a healthcare, whether it's education, whether it could be a financial inclusion, our needs are different. Our business needs are, or ecosystem needs are different. So we focus on our needs. Second is we focus on the problem more than a solution. Quite often it happens that our engineering workforce or intellectual focus on solving a problem, but who is to define the problem? That is the critical aspect in our engineering pool or brain pool we have. We require someone to define a problem for us. As we take some examples of Chota Cool and take some examples in the user innovation, this will become much more clearer. Third aspect of this, that we use technology, not for the sake of it, but we use technology for problem solving. We use technology as a tool rather than our intellectual stimulation. We use technology for the social good so that large population can be impacted on this. And our reliance on the foreign or the other third party would be lesser and lesser. And once we do this innovation, we get into this groove of innovation or solving our own problem, then we look outwards and see if this solution is applicable to the other communities also, maybe outside India. And then we export to the other developing countries, similar countries, and we export to even the third world or the developed countries on this side. So this aspect of Atmanirbhar is the thread that is running through the entire presentation, and you will see its exemplification as we move in the presentation. So we talk about the innovation. What is the innovation? I would just like to take a feedback of someone if I am audible or if there is some correction is needed on this.
Absolutely fine. Everything is absolutely fine.
All right. Thank you so much. So what is innovation? I mean, many people come has a various context of innovation, but for here or in general for the clarity, I would bring a very brief definition which will make it more understandable. Often innovation is equal to invention. Something like new idea, new discovery is considered as innovation, but which is not true. Innovation is more than that, and innovation is to bring value what you invest, what you innovate, or what new ideas or new techniques or new technology. So innovation is like faster, better, cheaper, and bring value to the innovator. While invention is a technology or an idea or a breakthrough or another new path that to solve a problem. But that idea alone sometimes does not generate value. But innovation is actually invention times commercialization. Unless we generate a value out of invention, innovation has relatively no value. In terms of digitization, you will say 1 and 0. If we can have a very good idea, new idea, innovative technology, but without commercialization, that is commercialization is 0, invention is also equal to 0. And if we have a commercialization of something, but does not have a new aspect into this, or does not solve a problem in a new way, then again, innovation is 0. So this definition, which I learned from MIT and the Professor Robert, this is a very clear indication of this. Mind you that the relationship between invention and commercialization is a product. Innovation times commercialization. It is not addition. It is not plus that you can have an invention, still you will have innovation. No, innovation necessarily requires commercialization, that is to drive value from the invention. So this is one aspect. And for many people who are practicing innovation, there is one more myth actually, that innovation is a noun. Innovation is something like noun's definition is something which is name of place, person or thing. So innovation is something which is aesthetic in nature, like Apple phone is an innovation, right? But innovation is more than that. It reflects in your action. So innovation is not just a noun, but a verb. So the way you do the commercialization, the way you do is innovation also. It's not necessarily the way you invent, but way you propose, the way you make a media, the way you make the appeal, the way you solve the problem, the process that with which you do this is also all inclusive of innovation. So innovation is invention and commercialization, and it is an action, not just aesthetic work. Some of the examples, if you see, that would probably make it clear, is for example, what comes to our mind is most innovative companies, Apple. So great invention of Apple, we say the Mac computer essentially. But you know, the invention necessarily did not come from Mac, from Apple. The Mac computer, the invention of the mouse has come from Xerox PARC. Xerox has invented the mouse, pointer mouse. It is the ingenuity of the Apple to commercialize it and make the innovation very successful. If we take another example from the Apple again, is iPod. iPod is an MP3 player, which was there anyway before that. And Apple, and this player was not invented by Apple. It was again invented by someone else, and Apple is very, very smart in commercializing it. So take this message for clear that invention when we are doing, it's not just engineering. So if we take, so for some of the students, what they study in engineering is basically the invention aspect, the newness of the thing, the new idea of it, the solving, how to solve a problem, how to apply a science in solving a problem. But this commercialization aspects is more or less is very low, makes the overall impact in the market or in the society is relatively low, and the innovation quotient for the country as a whole is quite low. It's less than our country stands about more than 150 countries ahead of us in terms of innovation as total. Okay? So this aspect needs to be impacted on this, the commercialization aspect of it. If we understand innovation a little more, innovation is usually not very obvious thing. Some, you know, the first aeroplane is invention. The first rail track is invention. The first penicillin or the anti-vaccine is innovation. The mobile phone is innovation. They are very obvious innovation, but there are some non-obvious innovation too. And take this example. This lettuce. Lettuce is available for years and years together. And the poly bag, which is a plastic poly bag, which is airproof, is also available. But this combination of the two makes the innovation, which drives the value. And what the value is? That the sale of lettuce increased by 30%. This is the case in South America. And it's a very price premium. So innovation need not to be a very supported by a breakthrough invention. It can be as simple as combining this lettuce with the airtight plastic poly bag, and then we can have a significant increase in the sale. So the spectrum of innovation is broader than what we often think about. Sometimes technology is already available, but it's in the business model, like Netflix. It's a screening is available, movie is available. They combine together and offer movie on demand and pay as you use. Similarly, Amazon, like combining all the stores together and bringing a model to deliver it. They break the supply chain innovation and then they connected the consumer and the supplier from the warehouse directly and brought the inefficiency from the system relentlessly. And that becomes an invention. Similarly, the Ryanair, which is a low-cost airline, or you can consider the Uber as a taxi services, these are the business model innovation on this. So I'm just touching upon the various innovation model on this. If we combine this together, just for the intellectual purpose, that there are various types of innovation, or various innovation can be in the technology itself. Innovation can be in the process, the way we make something or we produce something or create value. Innovation could be in service innovation. That means the way we deliver the service to the end consumer, and we can have innovation in that. And we can have a business model innovation, which is the way how we generate the value, or where in the value chain where we create the value. There are other types of innovation, the way which is based on the process of innovation, like open innovation, user-driven innovation, where user involved actively, frugal innovation, that means the focus on the core, technology push innovation, market pull innovation, competency creating innovation, competency destroying innovation. But there is one side we have a type of innovation, on the other side we have a category of innovation. And this category I'm giving you so that you can understand the nomenclature of the innovation around it, if you get a chance to read something around in this. But just for you to understand that there is the types of innovation, and you can have a category of innovation, like disruptive, that disrupted the market, radical innovation, something which was not there, but now you have in the market. I can give an example of this, but then we will move, will be defocused from our user innovation. And then you have an architectural innovation. You could have incremental innovation. So for each type, you can have each different category of innovation. There could be a technology innovation, and a disruptive innovation in the technology. That could be a process innovation, and that could be disruptive innovation. That could be service innovation, and that could be disruptive innovation. Right? And business model innovation, and that model itself is a disruptive. And if you want to take an example, business model, disruptive Netflix. Service innovation, disruptive Uber services. Process innovation is the way way we create the digital films. And the technology innovation is something, the way we do the CT scan. Similarly, radical, lateral, and disinnovation. So broadly, if we consider the innovation, there are three types: sustaining, breakthrough, and disruptive. So business model, which is a razor blade innovation, which is considered as that you produce a razor and then sell the razor every time. Every time you sell the blade, that is generate the revenue. So that's the business model innovation. This business model innovation was under significant challenge when the Kodak in the market was selling the film around it. And the digital camera and the mobile phone disrupted that market, because it's not a technology, just digital technology, but it's a business model innovation that has taken away or completely make the Kodak vanish from the scene. Existing model and the new business model innovation. I'm coming to the user innovation actually. So third aspect is the path. I consider the user innovation is a pathway to the entrepreneurship. You know what user innovation is? That user is to solve their own problem. User is has to know when, because for example, if you are looking for a Hindi typing or Hindi font on the computer, we have to solve our own problem. Essentially, no one will solve for us. If no one is solving for us, and if you consider this is a genuine problem, let's solve it. So I give you some examples without getting into theory, how to go about it, how to identify the problem, what is the model around it, what is the process around it. I'm giving it as a way so that from the example itself, you can understand what the issue is. I will only explain the issue. Problem. The first example is Indian example from a company. They are given the name of their technology is a Nano Ganesh. And you know the problem is this. It started with Gujarat. When Gujarat government has started giving the electricity, or promise to their farmer the electricity, always available from a specific time, from 11 o'clock to morning 4 o'clock. They created a separate electricity line of 1100 kilometers for three phase. But then this posed a challenge to the farmers, because farmer has to go out in the night to the field and make the pump on. And going there is a challenge actually, because they need to go again and close the pump again. And the terrain is not usually is a smooth. Sometimes it is marred with the insect and the reptiles. So this innovation is a simple innovation where a person will make a call to the pump or a machine and then dial some switch number 1, 2, 3 to make the pump on, make the pump off, or see what is the status of the pump, if there is electricity or there is no electricity. So it's a mobile based wireless automation system for controlling and monitoring water pumps and water levels in the tank. So, you know, this is, for example, overhead tank, which is about 1 to 10 kilometers. And then pump is in the hazardous condition, and the 10 kilometers per person has to travel to certain distance to make it on and off. The terrain could be difficult, heat could be an issue, night visits, rain, wild animal, labor and fuel, irregular electricity, all this combined together poses an issue and then create a need for this. So a company and a gentleman in Pune has created this Nano Ganesh pump, which is an electric starter combined with as a mobile phone connected with a mobile modem, and that is connected to the water pump. And that water tank or water pump uses a sensor, which is a driver for the motor, and then it connects, give an alert to the Nano Ganesh. So user can use a normal telephone and make a call to that SIM card which is there in the electrical starter. You need to buy two SIM cards. One is in the phone, one is in the electrical starter, and make a call. This call can be from any phone. Of course, there is a password to protect this. Now, as soon as you dial in, you will hear the beep. Once you hear the beep, that different types of beep will tell you whether there is electricity, there is no electricity, and then user will be able to take a decision. He want to make a pump on, then he press something like button like 2 or 3. If you need to make the pump off, you will press the button 3 or 2 to do that. and then he's done with this. Now, this seems to be a very simple innovation. But it was invented, I think, sometimes 2007 and 8, and then it served the farmers of 5,000. The penetration rate was less, but once it get exposed in 2014, I mean, world over, it got the requirement. And I think many of you will also can draw analogy that if you want to operate something remotely, as simple as this, you can also apply your innovation and solve your own problem. Here are two links. You can search with in Times of India, and there is a documentary by the international community on nanovelation. This is one example. Another example is that this about, it's in US actually, and it's an old example, 1930. This Professor Gibson, who was a doctor actually, was a very famous cardiologist actually, and used to operate the open heart bypass surgeries. One incident, a young patient died on the table, and he was so much moved by that that the current technology on at that point in time does not allow them to operate when the lungs is on or when the patient is alive. Because in the previous cases, they need to make the artificial bypass machine for the hurt lungs, bypass machine, that and the heart need to be revived after the operation. And this causes a significant percentage of people die from this. Gibson was disturbed by this, and he asked many companies actually. He, for 4 years, he kept on asking that can someone design a machine and he can provide the insight that how to make or develop a heart and lung bypass machine. It didn't work. Then he himself made a prototype and successfully conducted an operation. And he demonstrated on animal and also on human, and then goes to company and say, can you absorb and commercialize this invention? And no response from the various important companies. They started looking into it, but they were focused on the high market, high margin innovation. And Professor left this job. He invested his time learning the nuances of engineering and make this machine. And this user machine is the first innovation from a physician, which is as high as life-saving on the heart bypass machine, and live operation started happening on the cardiac. So user innovation. If you heard about this Khan Academy, khanacademy.org, you can learn anytime. This started with a very small need. When Salman Khan, not the actor one, but the Salman Khan in US, he was working in a McKinsey company at that point in time. He was an MIT graduate and an MBA Harvard, was working with a consultancy, and he has his niece used to ask him some questions. She used to stay away from him, and he used to call her and guide her how to solve mathematical problem or how to explain certain things. But often this happens that consultancy job kept him quite occupied, and by the time when he has a time, his niece was busy in playing or something else. When his niece has time, he doesn't have time. So he started creating videos for her. And these videos he used to post on this. Later on, posting and losing the video is becoming posing a challenge. So he started long that it is not only my problem, it could be a problem of everyone of her age. And online tuition are not engaged. So he created a video and posting it on a website. And that website that you know today is the Khan Academy. It's the founding way. It has created a completely new change or new paradigm change in the education industry. And after that, rest is history. Currently, you can learn anything from this website, whether it's in music, history, maths, science, grammar, or any hobby. You name it, it's there. Similarly, there are numerous examples actually. This kids tricycle is invented by a lady who wanted to take her baby out. So jogging stroller invented by people. Similarly, the car seat for the children was invented by user. And if you take many such examples, the industry is filled with user-driven innovation. There are numerous examples. If I go through this, like call center for blind. Call center for blind is like this, that blind people does not like to, they want to earn their own. They would not like to be considered as other or a beggar. So they wanted a solution that they can earn their earnings. What they cannot see is the screen, but they can do everything as a normal human being. So here is a call center that translates the entire screen into an audio. And they can, in a normal fashion, they can reply, they can make a call to the customer of an enterprise and take a response and feed it back using a touch phone or using a keypad of the phone. If you have seen the phone has got over the number, they have got one ABCDEFG. So based on this key, they can fetch the order numbers on this. And this becomes a equal opportunity job for all blinds in call center. This is operational in Mumbai, Delhi, Bangalore, and close to 65-70 people have been employed. I have seen it myself. So, you know, a blind person can make calls for about 100-150 calls, out of which they get 3 rupees per call, and that is sufficient for them to earn a livelihood. Similar story from dive for an oceanography, collecting data, temperature data all over the world, which was unavailable, research fund was not available. And here is Daira, who found that divers are there all over the world. It's just that we need to enable them to provide the temperature data so that they can study the ecology of the ocean across the world. And she come up with a community where all the people who are diving at various beaches, various places, ship or anything, they carry this device, which they anyway carry to measure the temperature and the depth of the dive. She created a community that allow these divers to upload the data. Now, why would someone upload the data is the business model. So what she created, a profile of individual users. So divers will get a chance to see what is the condition across the world. So if anyone is planning their vacation, they can discover more places where they can do the scuba diving and discover more and more newer places and the new locations. And this created a vibrant community, and not only scientists got benefited out of it. Without funding, she could create a community where the data points usually available less than 500, she could collect more than 5 million data points for this solvable study. This is story of Lucy. When she came back from her international assignment back to US, she found that her dog is losing weight and the dog food is a second grade. So she tried all if she could get the good food of it, but later on she decided to create lunch packets for her own dog. And that created a new company, which is the second largest company now in this. This is the Honest Kitchen for the pet food. So list is too many of innovation, steak boards, Lego, surfing board, numerous examples of this user innovation. I'll just give you two aspects of this user example and then we'll go into more. But this user example is that this typical lead user innovation, the theory says that you have to identify the need of the user. And this need is so latent that companies are not paying any attention to that. And someone has to pay enough attention that is this need is genuine and can be applicable to the large part of the population, then it makes sense to invest into it. So normally the firms and economic theory focuses on the center of the perceived user need, which is the center of this graph. And the lead user at the edge of this graph, where the generally the need and demand or the value cost ratio is very high. And this is how we also need to be aware of this need of our country, need of our society, identify those problems and apply those applied engineering and technology knowledge and solve that problem in an engineering way, and then apply innovation, creativity, and commercialization of this product when we productize it, and then we have an innovation for this. So the phases of the growth for lead with innovation are the first three phases, and the rest is the history that we create. So this is what I think, that for India to look into or get into this groove of high performing or high entrepreneurship or economy, they, a large population can embrace the lead user innovation or innovation. This is the pattern of innovation for people who are more interested in research on this can use this aspect. The pioneer person who started this concept and brought into our notice is Professor Eric Von Hippel from MIT. Here are some of the examples of the user innovation and this. Now I bring your attention to another concept of reverse innovation. Ma'am, how much time do we have? I think another 10 minutes.
Yes, sir.
Yes,
sure.
Sir. We yes, have 10 minutes. Can continue.
Okay.
Yes,
sir. Now I brought this innovation that in this lead user innovation, you have been focusing on problem solving your problem. How enterprise can take advantage of this lead user concept and make this product at a scale? Anyone heard about this Chotu Cool from Godrej? The aspect is the reverse innovation is that we do it for the, we identify the latent need, make a product around that community, serve that community, and also transport or export this to the world. That's a reverse innovation. So we start with the user requirement and then solve this. You know what happens in the Godrej, which is the FMCG company and historically known for refrigerators in Indian market, and continuously launching the new product. But you know, with lot of competition, they say their sale was decreasing actually, and lot of international companies are occupying the market. But at the same time, the refrigerator market was 16%, 84% is available for to be occupied, particularly in rural. So more than Indian 80% of the population does not have average refrigerator, and 50% earn less than $2. So they said, let's develop a fridge refrigerator, which is 50% of the current cost. And the study took Godrej a journey of entire new innovation on this. Now here is something which is not there in the most of the case studies, is that Godrej started with developing a technological breakthrough in reducing the cost. And in 1.5 years, they could hardly do much about it because the innovation is much limited. How much you can do further when other people is also innovating with you. So when they approached to the Professor Clayton Christensen from Harvard, he actually asked a very pertinent question and asked that you are developing a fridge which should be half of its cost. Who are your customers? And what is their requirement? And they said, fridge requirement is a fridge requirement. What is the big deal about it? Requirement we know very well. We just need to reduce the cost so that we can penetrate in the market. And that's where Clayton Christensen challenged them. He said, you are working on a solution. You are not working on a problem. Problem definition is assumed. We need to do innovative approach to identify the problem in much more depth than we know or we perceive. And he actually envisaged and then monitored and created and conducted in under his supervision a survey of 600 villages across Maharashtra and allied places. And he observed them, and the way he did, there is a quite an elaborated methodology of doing this survey for R&D survey, like not a paper and pen basis, ethnographic survey, and then we have a lead user survey, and then we have a focus group research. And then he came up in his survey, six requirements. The requirement one was so simple, says that the food or the leftover of the night should be reusable next day morning. They don't need to keep a vegetable for 7 days, which is there in the urban area. Another is they're not looking for a refrigeration for the ice, actually, for the freezer. They are looking for something that water temperature should be, I mean, the refrigerator should bring a temperature difference of about 5 to 7 degrees. So the water kept inside the refrigerator should be 7-8 degrees cooler than what is the ambient temperature. This is the point. It should work on the battery because electricity supply is irregular, very general. Fridge is not required to be serving in the room, in the home, because everyone in that rural family, almost everyone is working. So no one is there at home, but they want this refrigerator to be at their shop. So it should be portable. You know, these are requirements which is coming out of the survey when we involve the lead user and ask them what is their requirement. And these are the requirements. No one wanted fridge. And this started completely and revamped their project engineering right from the beginning. And now when they have this requirement in hand, they came up with a solution quite quickly. Close to 150 components has been removed from the existing refrigerator. The compressor, which was a very expensive component, is not there in the fridge now. And they came up with a 12-liter or 26-liter chota cool refrigerator, which is portable and can be kept in shop, can be kept in home. This is the refrigerator, looks like this. And this cost is not just half, not just means 7,500, which they were looking for. It is actually, they're selling it at 3,500 in the market. And if you're interested, you can buy. And in rural, there are case studies where pawn shop person increased his income by 2 to 3 times by keeping the pawn inside it. It's weight just less than 8 kgs, work on 12-volt batteries, and it the largest one is up to 43 liters. So what we learn from here is that there is a significant need when we consider the user's requirement. User's requirement need to be re-engineered. I emphasize, need to be re-engineered rather than assumed. And then we focus on developing a particular solution. So that's the story of chota cool. Similarly, Tata Swachh water purifier, you know, the country in India, we have 75% of the rural population does not have access to the safe drinking water. What could be shameful than this? 500,000 children in the India come to the diarrhea because of this unsafe drinking water. Corona pandemic, if you compare, it's much more than that. Much more than that. And Tata has collaborated this, and they came up with a water purifier which is close to the WHO standard, and they uses the husk and the nanotechnology. Using Tata Chemical actually helped doing this, and Ratan Tata himself has taken a lead role or facilitating this, motivating this, and they came up with this water purifier which does not require electricity and can do up to 9 or 10 liters of the water in that container. Similarly, people who are on the walk, this is not Indian innovation, but of course, Life Straw. On the same principle, Tata has also come up with a Life Straw-like solution where you don't need to store. Just put that Life Straw in the water and suck the water. And as you suck the water, this is a clean and it filter out 99% of the waterborne pathogens. So these are the social, I don't mean NGO, I mean large, impacting large populations and the social good-based innovation. And they are centered around the user need. So this is the basis of the Life Straw. And the important is that it removes the 99.9% of waterborne bacteria.
Sir, I would like to interrupt. There is one question from the audience side.
Yeah, surely.
So the question is, leaving aside top corporates and conglomerates, how can MSME invest their retained earnings into R&D when it is nothing but a sunk cost for them?
You know, R&D is, okay, we can address this part. But you know, R&D is not just for the R&R purpose. It's not R&R, it's an R&D, it's a development. And development has to be focused for a particular problem, to solve a problem. And once we have conceived a problem, then if we solve a problem, it will be applicable, its applicable market is available, and we can start from there. R&D is not a sunk cost anyway. And if it is for some industry, like I know for the communication side and I know for the high-end technology R&D, yes, it is, because we need to reach to that level. And that way, we need to travel some time. We have some time to travel. But to solve our problem, which we see often around us, we don't need high technology to do. And all these examples actually say that we can start right now. Let me give you one example of this. For example, if you go further from this, I know this question is not answered completely, but let me go through this slides and then we can think about it. I park this question for some time. I think it's okay, right? Can I park this question or should I answer it right now?
Sir, please we continue.
Okay. So as we seen that this reverse innovation, you know, the economic growth worldwide is 5.5%, which is generating about 1.5 trillion growth. And the GDP per capita, if you see, the demographic or the fundamental are quite different. Here, in the developed economy, it's 1% can spend about $1,000. Here, in the developing economy, they can spend up to $1. But such 1,000 people can spend $1. So because this fundamental difference in the demand structure, we suddenly have to renovate, completely renovate. Take the example of GE CT scan. And this is a true story. GE CT scan costs $50,000. 80% of population do not have a big hospital. So hospital needs to go to patient because hospitals are not there. So hospital needs to go to patient. It weighs 200 LV. Electricity is not available or unreliable. It requires a specialist to operate. And this is the issue. We need to completely rethink or redesign this requirement. It is not the time that we can take the innovation of the West as it is and apply in a miniature way to Indian environment. We cannot, because demand structure is quite different. And that requires, this aspect of commercialization requires ingenuity and innovation and creativity. Similarly, ECG machine now. It's portable. It's less than, it's cost, it's weight less than a Coke can. It's a new invention. It is for the developing world. It's battery operated. It has just two buttons, very simple to operate, and cost less than 500. See this. This is the ECG machine. Anyone can operate. So if we just touch upon some theoretical aspect, that the focus is on the bottom of pyramid, which is the aspiring and deprived. And India, if we do that part, probably we will be focusing 70-75% of our population. I'll just bring one attention to you from a medical and healthcare industry, the medical device innovation in IIT. The worldwide demand or industry for the medical device is 400 billion. India needs annually 600 billion investment for these devices on annual basis. And India imports out of this 6 billion, 80% of medical devices. In India, there are only 800 manufacturers and only 300 are licensed. Such a big, huge gap. Consider this example of IT, Biotech, Biomedical Technology Innovation Center, digital stethoscope. They created existing stethoscope with this IUSync, which goes between the stethoscope and remotely they can hear the voice of the lungs. Now there are 200 different types of audio signals which doctor need to discriminate. So this device can discriminate the audio type and can probably help a doctor to identify this. because otherwise to identify or discriminate this different audio or different signals, you require a specialist. So this is a digital scope. You can connect to your mobile phone's Bluetooth, and a doctor can be sitting 100 kilometers away, 200 kilometers away, can listen clearly the heartbeat and the breath signal from the child or from anybody or their children. And they are deployed. Actually, if you see the last corner of this, the ATM machines, something like ATM machine. Connect this stethoscope to this machine, and the doctor on the remote can hear that this is a cardiac issue or a lungs issue. And you can, and accordingly, he can identify that you have an emergency or you can wait for something. These are the various laparoscopy instruments, which are, they are not replacement. They are significant enhancement in this. If I take this example of each of this, probably this is an innovation in itself, each one. And so much close to 40 products has been developed by this medical device innovation team at IIT. This knee, ankle, or prosthetic legs is completely remote. They automated it so much that you just put the images of your body, that means your leg, or put the measurement, and your stethoscope can be 3D printed and courier to you in next 24 hours. Earlier, it used to take 3 weeks, and person has to travel to the place to get the measurement, second time to make the fitment, and then collect it. And this requires about 2 weeks time or 3 weeks time. Now is online. That kind of innovation is required. This is an example that demonstration was happening, and I happened to be in that lab. So this is the photograph from there. Jaipur leg has been in process of automation. So there are many things actually in India. Arvind eye surgery reduces the cataract surgery cost from $3,000 to just $30. Quality, no compromise. Narayan Hriday Hospital, open heart surgery, from $50,000 to $2,000. And they're conducting at a mass scale. They're creating another 2,000 bed heart specialty hospital in a Cayman Island, which is about 100 kilometers away from in US. Mobile is such a great tool for us that replaced the complete need for the fixed landline and moved us to the mobile. So point I am trying to draw is that the examples we can draw one after another, many examples actually for us to learn. But point is that focus is that we require a paradigm shift in our innovation approach. A paradigm shift in innovation approach. And we have to do more and more with less and less that we have. We don't need to get a best world-class innovation, technology breakthrough. No. We need the creativity to use that technology for the purpose. And engineer our requirement much more than what we have. And believe me, it is not an option. It is not an option for us. India at that verge that it is an oxygen for us. And with this pandemic, it is more and more pertinent. I would advise some of you to read this book, actually, The Fortune at the Bottom of the Pyramid, written by late Professor C.K. Prahlad. And it has an exemplary study on this bottom of the pyramid, how to focus on it, how to identify the problem, how do we need to innovate on this. And some of the characteristics of the reverse innovation probably we would like to take into account that India has 1.2 billion population, second in the world, and total GDP of 4 trillion. And if we continue to adopt what is the innovation done in the developed country, it will not need our suffice. Take example for the video surveillance, which is the need of the world. Every fifth house has got a video camera these days. And we are paying so much in the face recognition license fees or the camera accommodation, and it's engineering in a cloud. We have this solution. Like, there is a company which manufactures camera, there is a company which manufactures glasses, there is a company which does the face recognition. They can even recognize your face from the face mask. They can recognize. They can recognize the thermal temperature. But all this innovation are not yet integrated, and it is a time for us to. So this is so much, or this is as little as on the first innovation. What message I'm trying to give is that we need to challenge the conventional paradigm. Trust me, each and every user can innovate, just use their skills. And if skills are not there, get it. Use the skill to solve your own problem. You have to address your own problem to get people's attention. Once you frame the problem and fit to your skill and solve it, it becomes and diffuse your innovation to the community, not to the world. Just the community you think that they should be able to use it. You can give free, but build the community, like Oceanographer. Build the community. Once you build the community, you are actually democratizing the innovation. And once you democratize the innovation and it perfects in itself, it becomes a usable thing, it solves the problem, increase the productivity, and then you can go for reverse innovation. That means you can earn premium on your innovation. And that is how India can leverage its skill, a large pool of intellectuals, large pool of engineers, to translate their engineering skill into a problem-solving skill, combining with the problem-solving skill. Of course, we have a gap in commercialization skill, which we call it a technology management aspect. And for example, in Indore, we don't have any institute that focuses on the technology and technology management aspect or innovation management using technology. Once that combined together, probably we will have much more successful entrepreneur than what we have today. If you want to learn more from this democratizing innovation, there is a book called Democratized Innovation by Ivan Hippel from MIT. And there is a website also for teaching. You can learn much more from what. Into this presentation, I borrowed many things from various sources and put together for you to discuss. We are close to the session. And if you have any question and answer, we can take them.
So one more question is from audience side.
Yeah.
Big companies can build brands that can resonate with users, as it happened with Godrej Chutkul, by ad campaigns and promotions. How can small players invoke similar trust and brand equity for new products?
Okay. A part of the answer is already there in this presentation, which is like Nano Ganesh. Have you heard before Nano Ganesh? It is an international brand these days. They created a niche for themselves. IoT is so much of a big field that you can go to agriculture and you will find 10 things to do. You can go to medical and healthcare, you will find 20 things to do. You go to any field, touch any field, and you will find the need for IoT. It is an example of IoT. And then without brand, they can be successful because they are solving the problem. So I think the brand building will come later. Think, diffuse the innovation, democratize it. Once it democratizes, get the attention and reverse engineer, reverse innovate. That means send it back to the world for their attention and for their use and adoption. Any other questions?
One question is from my own side. As you told about reverse innovation. So if I ask you a question, that where did you apply reverse innovation and which is the most important thing which you or important incident which you remember about the same while working?
Prosthetic leg. Prosthetic leg is something which is need of the world. People have been developing it in their own ways actually, but re-engineering the entire process from taking the measurement from the web itself, then using those measurement and deriving additional measurement so that the leg can be printed. The data can be fed from an AutoCAD machine directly for 3D printing and then assembly. and then goes to the packaging shop, package it and send it. This is actually, I would say, reverse innovate, because the orders are not coming from India and far-fetched plate, but all across the world. So that way, I consider this is one example of the reverse innovation. And there could be this one medical lab as digital stethoscope, which is there actually available in the market. But applying an AI is not there in the model that I've shown you, but in the recent version, they have applied an AI, artificial intelligence, to discriminate various types of audio voices coming from the breathing, and then discriminate and assisting doctor that what could be the diagnosis of this. So this is again applicable and not available generally in the world. This, you see the third one from the top and bottom, is something that a laparoscopic instrument. Today there is no laparoscopic instrument that can rotate at the knob. So you can collect the information or collect the sample for the histopathology clearly. Doctor actually has to tilt the entire instrument, which is about a 12 inch or 15 inch long, make the hole larger, and also they cannot collect the right sample from the inner side of the tissues. This becomes a very useful activity. And if you take the needle out, this instrument is reusable. Currently, this needle is tightly attached in our case. And in Indore, if you do any operation, they'll charge you 600-650 rupees for this instrument, because every operation requires a sample collection for the histopathology. And in the doubt, there could be a cancer cells, they don't use it or reuse it. But with this needle at the top, you can just replace the needle, which cost about 100-150, and then you can use this instrument for multiple things. So these are the possibilities for this. Water purifier, of course, is reverse innovation. But demand in India is so much, actually, that unless we fulfill ourselves, the need for foreign countries would be less. So we have to travel this journey from solving our own problem, maturing it with a good proposition, and then take a leap from the side. But at least, as I say, that we have to start this journey from the first step, even the baby small step. I hope this answered to some extent.
Yes, sir, definitely. So, in adding to previous question, how to garner the so-called attention to democratize the innovation in the first place? How to build that trust factor to bank upon?
Trust factor for what purpose? I mean, trust that people will not use your instrument because it's not coming from a reputed brand, is that? Is that the question? I'm so sorry, actually, I could not get the question.
Yes, sir, this is only the question, right? How to garner the so-called attention to democratize the innovation in the first place? How to build that trust factor to bank upon?
Community. Because you are solving a problem of community, you will actually solve their problem. And as you solve the problem in your own community, you are known and you solve the problem of 200 people. These 200 people actually solve the problem of another 200 into multiplied by another 10 and 2000 people. That's how you democratize the innovation. Go with the community and it's problem solving. Only you need to worry when you invest significant time, and if you have multiple ideas, then think or run it in your own mind that which problem will address the larger community at this point, which will have more acceptability. Because you are solving someone's known problem, chances of its acceptability is much more. Currently, the innovation or the new product acceptance is less than 15%. Out of 10 or out of 100, only 6 or 7% product gets successful. But user innovation, success rate is more than 50 to 60%. I won't say success rate, I would say actually adoption rate.
Lalji sir, I would like to mute your mic.
So that way, probably you can build that trust with me. So,
thank you so much, sir. Now I would like to ask Majan sir to say a few words to sir. Majan sir.
Thank you, Mr. Dr. Dharmesh, for giving such an informative talk to us, talking about the innovation, the reversible innovation, touching the all the areas of social life, maybe it medical, maybe it technical, or maybe it village, or maybe it a poor person. Thank you very much. And I thank my management for providing us an opportunity for producing this event. Thank to every participant who has participated in this. Thank everybody. Raji sir, kuch bolna chahenge? Hello, Raji sir, kuch bolna chahenge aap?
शायद सर का
थैंक यू सो मच सर थैंक यू सो मच